Hello, we're glad you've joined us for this live webinar, Flipper in Drug Discovery, Ion Channel Screening and Cardiac Safety Testing. I am Judy O'Rourke-Labroots, and I'll be moderating this session. Today's educational web seminar is presented by Labroots, the leading scientific social networking website and provider of virtual events and webinars advancing scientific collaboration and learning. It's brought to you by Molecular Devices, one of the world's leading providers of high-performance bioanalytical instrumentation, software, and consumables, and is dedicated to helping customers unravel the complexity of biological systems. So let's get started. You can pose questions to the speakers during the presentation while they're fresh in your mind. To do so, simply type them into the drop-down box located on the far left of your screen, labeled Ask a Question, and click on the Send button. Questions will be answered after the presentation. To enlarge the slide window, click on the arrows at the top right-hand corner of the presentation window. If you experience technical problems seeing or hearing the presentation, just click on the support tab found at the top right of the presentation window, or report your problem by typing it into the Answer a Question box located on the far left of your screen. This is an educational webinar and thus offers free continuing education credits. Please click on the Continuing Education Credits tab located at the top right of the presentation window and follow the process of obtaining your credits. I now present today's speakers, Helma Vandenhoek, PhD, the Chief Operations Officer at PPSC, and Chung-Wai Lum, an Assay Development Scientist at PPSC. Helma Vandenhoek has a solid background in medical biology in fields ranging from neurology, developmental biology and diabetes, to innate immunity and cancer. While working toward her doctorate on Alzheimer's disease and a subsequent postdoctorate on renal cell carcinomas, she gained ample experience in cell biology, molecular biology, and biochemistry. Previously, she worked as head of R&D at Hycult Biotech, a Dutch company focused on assays, antibodies, and proteins in the field of innate immunity. Her complete bio is found on the Labroots website. Chung-Wai Lum has worked in different research departments at the Dutch pharmaceutical company Organon. As a member of H2 lead teams, he was responsible for developing, optimizing, and automating different types of biochemical and cellular assays and managing a small group of technicians for routine assays. He also worked in the quality control department. There, he was responsible for developing and optimizing cellular assays for product release. His complete bio is also found on the Labroots website. Helma Vandenhoek and Chung-Wai Lum will now begin their presentations.
Welcome everyone at the presentation called Flipper in Drug Discovery, Ion Channel Screening and Cardiac Safety Testing. My name is Helma Vandenhoek and thank you for the kind introduction and for having us giving this live webinar. And moving to the next slide, I will start with a short introduction of the Pivot Park Screening Center, the company where we work, and then my colleague Chung will take over and tell you more about the 1536 well screening campaign we did using the Flipper from Molecular Devices, as well as showing some calcium kinetics in cardiac safety testing using cardiomyocytes from Encardia, close collaboration project. So more to come, but I will start with a short introduction about the Pivot Park Screening Center for those who are not familiar with our company. So who are we? The Pivot Park Screening Center, abbreviated as PPSC, is an independent contract research organization and we are specialized in early drug discovery services. Of course, as all companies, we also have a mission, the discovery of new medicines for a healthier society. How do we do that? So as a company, we offer different services. From assay development, either biochemical or cell-based, we do have a huge infrastructure of which you will see some pictures later on in the presentation, where we can form ultra-high throughput screening from just tens or thousands of compounds up to millions of compounds that we can screen in a very efficient and automated way. And we can also support biological profiling during hit-to-lead phases. So that's in general the services that we offer as a company. So where is the PPSC located? So we are in a nice old building at the Pivot Park, a life science park in Os in the Netherlands. This life science park originated after the closure of the research facilities within Organon, MSD, Schering, Plough, those different companies that were located here previously in 2011. They closed all the research facilities and a life science park was started. If you see now here on the, all the different logos are the different companies that currently are residing here on this life science park. A lot of companies are working very actively in the early pharma research settings, and quite a lot of these companies are already very successful, if you see the kind of names. So people have started to do their own research and have even made it already into the clinics. So that's nice environment to be as a company, and we can offer there our automation and expertise in the early drug discovery screening part to all the different companies. This slide, you can see a short overview. As mentioned, as a company, just started in 2012, but we are building on the big history of screening that was done within Organon, Schering, Plough, and MSD at later times. And earlier this year, we have finished our screening campaign number 100 within the PPSC, so that's just in 5 years' time. So I think that's a nice achievement. So if you see at the numbers that we do produce, and this is all high-quality data points that we have, started in 2013 with screening, and last year we touched upon 12 million data points in a year. As you can see on the different colors, it's not only services that we offer, we are also the screening center within the European Lead Factory, and we do have some shared risk projects that I will tell a little bit more about in a number of slides. Due to these 100 screening campaigns, we have gained already experience in a huge broad range of therapeutic areas and a lot of different target classes, as you can see depicted on this slide, from proteases, ligases, receptors, ion channels, protein-protein interactions, and for the ion channel, you will hear more in the second part of this presentation from my colleague Chang. As mentioned, we are also not only working as a contract research organization, but also involved as partner in all kinds of innovative projects and shared risk projects. I already mentioned European Lead Factory, which is a huge initiative which was sponsored by the IMI and with 30 partners, among which 7 from the FPIA. We performed 72 high throughput screening campaigns in 5 years' time. I think it was quite an achievement and it's still continuing, I would say. Just the first optimization programs are ongoing. Next to that, we are involved in a cancer drug discovery initiative where we focus on the oncology area, and together with the Netherlands Cancer Institute and the Leiden University, we jointly develop clinical candidates in the oncology area. And a similar kind of initiative we have with the University of Nijmegen, where we focus on the epigenetics and are working on screening for novel candidates there. This picture is showing that we are in the center and we have a lot of different interactions with all kinds of companies and universities, and are always open for new collaborations as well to stay as a front runner there. What you see here is our fully automated infrastructure, which can be used to produce over 150,000 data points per day. It's fully automated, so it's nice. If you're in the neighborhood, you're always welcome to come and see the infrastructure. We are very proud of what we have here. And next to that, it's fully automated. Also, the data processing goes fully automated. Everything is being tracked, no manual interference there. We use software from IDBS and Dotmatics to do all the data analysis. It's moving to the next slide. So that, in short, was my introduction. I would now like to hand over to my colleague, Chang, who will tell you more about the actual flipper screening, ion channel screening that we have performed, and the cardiomyocyte testing that's ongoing. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Alma. So in the second part of this webinar, I will show you two examples of a flipper application. So the first application is a 1536 well screen using an ion channel assay from Molecular Devices. And as a second application, I will show you calcium kinetics used for cardiac safety testing. And it was done in close collaboration with Encardia, and that is a company, a Dutch company based in Leiden, which is specialized in stem cell and drugs discovery. So just a few words about the Flipper Tetra instrument itself. So on this slide, you see a schematic view of the Flipper instrument. And at the top of that, you see the pipette head, and that the pipette head is easily exchangeable between a 96, a 384, and a 1536 well pipettor. At the left of this view, of this scheme, you see the robotic landing path, which is important, so we can integrate this flipper in our robotic system from IRS. And a few other parts to mention is the tip washer, which I will come back to you later this webinar. Cell reservoir, which can be used to dispense cells or any other fluids into your assay plate. And then there are three other stages left for plates. And below you see the position of the camera. We use an ICCD camera that can be measuring both luminescence and fluorescence. And one other item for the Flipper Tetra, it can be temperature controlled from ambient up to 40 degrees. Sorry. So something about the assay principle of the Flipper. So Molecular Devices has several assay kits that can be used to monitor different cellular processes. So on this slide, you see the Flipper potassium assay kit. And this kit uses a dye that is sensitive for thallium. So what you do is you are seeding the cells, and after that you load the dye with the cells, and the dye contains a thallium-sensitive dye that is permeable for the cells, and after it enters the cell by passive diffusion, it is being cleaved, so the AM portion of the dye is being cleaved, and then when it binds to thallium, it produces a bright fluorescence light. And the level of fluorescence is proportional to the activity of the to the ion channels. Another assay kit available for Flipper is the calcium assay kit. So essentially, this kit is the same as the same principle as the ion channel assay kit. It uses, in this case, a dye that is sensitive for transient calcium levels in the cell. And the general protocol is the same. So you are loading cells, plating cells. You add the dye enters the cell, the AN portion is cleaved off, and after binding to calcium, it produces a bright fluorescence that can be read in the Flipper. So, a typical working flow of a Flipper assay on a robotic system you see on this slide. And well, it's not only usable for Flipper, for actually for any HTS screening protocol. So we start with at A, it's dispensing the cells with an, the multi-top combi. Sorry, I just forgot the name. After that, the cells are incubated for a certain time. The next day, it's depending on if your assay is sensitive for the medium. So the medium in which the cells are dispensed can be interference with your assay readout. So we use the blue washer to remove the medium. And after that, using a other dispenser, the buffer is added. After that, we would add the dye with a flex drop. In the meantime, we prepare our intermediate plates with compounds that are transferred by an acoustic dispenser, the echo. buffer is added to the compound plate, and after that both cell plate and the intermediate plate are transferred to the flipper, where compound is transferred to the assay plate and readout starts within the flipper. So the flowchart you saw on the previous slide is actually the final protocol for an HCS assay. But before you coming there, you have to optimize and develop your assay. So there are a lot of things you can optimize in your assay. And on this slide, we have just named a few of those optimization steps. So for a cell assay, you can think of the cell density, the use of frozen cells or just cultured cells, the culture conditions, do you use a serum in it or not, other things like the stability of the reagent. Also important is the plate selection, because we have noticed that the same type of plates can have a huge different effects if ordered at the different suppliers. And one other important optimization step is the dispensers and your devices that you are using, for instance, the flipper. So on the next slide, you see a few examples of the flipper optimization. And the first example I would like to give is the dispensing technique. So like any other dispenser, the technique with which you dispense your fluid is very important. So on this slide, you see a screenshot from the flipper where you can edit your dispense techniques. So at the upper, you see with a circle the consecutive steps that are being processed by the flipper. So you see the settings and analysis in green, and then a few blocks in, I think it's blue-purple, with mixing in intermediate, and then transfer steps from your intermediate into your assay plate. And below, you see two blocks which you can adjust your aspirate steps and your dispense steps. So I would like to focus on the dispense steps below. You will see encircled the height at which you dispense. So that is expressed in microliters from the bottom, and the speed expressed as the microliters per second. So you can imagine that if you are playing with the speed, with a higher speed, generally you would get a better mixture of your fluids. But if you would dispense with a too high speed, the cells in your cells could be detached. And the same goes for your height. If you would dispense at a too low level, the cells also could be detached. And of course, these are also depending on the type of cells you are using. So on this slide, you see an example of our optimizing the dispense speed and height. So just explaining what you are seeing here, at the upper image, you see two curves, a yellow one and a blue one. The blue one is DMSO, and the yellow one is an agonist that stimulates the cells and generates the bright fluorescence. And sorry, you see that the dispense speed was set at 1 microliter per second, and the dispense height was set at 4 microliter per second. And there were for each, for both DMSO and the agonist, there were 464 bells used. So the average is those 64 bells are averaged, and the CV is expressed as the error bars. And you see that there are pretty high error bars in at every time point you measure. At the image below, it's actually done the same. but then the dispense speed is set at 5 microliters per second, so much faster, and the dispense height has been lowered. What you there see is that the error bars are much lower or less. Another thing that can be seen is that when you look at the x-axis, where the time scale is set, normally we would do a pre-measurement of 10 seconds, then we dispense the DMSO or the agonist, and then we continue the reading. At the upper part, you see that the start of the signal is for more than 1 minute, and in the lower image, where the dispense speed is much higher, you see that it's already at after 10, 20 seconds that you see the increase of your fluorescent signal. So the response to your stimulant is much, much faster. Another example of the optimization of the flipper is the tip wash procedure, because the 1536 well tips are fixed tips that are used for every transfer in the flipper. Between each transfer, the tips have to be washed, so you make sure that all the reagents or compounds from the previous transfer are washed out. The flipper with the flipper you can choose between two different fluid types you can connect to the flipper. And on this screen you see a screenshot with a tab where you can set all the different wash procedures. What you see is, for example, the wash cycle. So the wash cycle is the number of times that the wash station is being emptied and fresh solution is being filled, and the number of strokes. And the number of strokes is the number of up and downs from the pipette head. And other things you can set are the volumes, the holding time, and all of settings. So we have tested different settings with the wash cycle and the strokes to ensure that all the reagents from the previous transfer are being washed out. So on this slide and the next one, you will see the procedure we have followed. So we have taken a 1536 well plate. We have filled it with an agonist. You see that with in columns 3, 4, and 9 to 48. And in columns 5 and 6, the DMSO is filled. And columns 3, 4, 5, 6, we used as negative and positive controls, and all the effects of every well is expressed as percentage effect as compared to the controls. After we have transferred this to this plate with the 1536 well head, we have washed the head, and then measured again the plate and see what residual effect was seen in the flipper. So we have tested the different washing procedures. So at the left, you see a washing procedure that had two cycles, and each cycle had three strokes. And at the right, you see a washing procedure that had three cycles and four strokes. And well, you see easily that the first procedure with only two cycles had a lot of residual effect left. And the right image where we increased the number of cycles and strokes had almost all the residual effects washed out. So we also tried more wash cycles with more strokes. And well, they always kept so a few wells that had about 10% effect left, but this was acceptable for our washing procedure. And well, of course, you can say, well, you just wash a lot of times. But what I didn't mention yet is that the flipper also contains a layer. We call that a gasket, and that gasket is placed between the pipetter and the pipette head. And that gasket must be replaced every 300 strokes. So if you have a lot of washing steps. You have also a lot of waste, but also having to replace a lot of gaskets. So it's also always a balance between minimizing the number of washing steps and washing out all your residual reagents from your tips. Another optimization step we did for this protocol was looking at the CV of your plate. So as I said, we have the blue washer, and with the blue washer we can wash the plate, so evacuate all the medium that is in the plate and then replace it with buffer. So in the upper image you see a plate that is with cells and with medium. And after doing the protocol on the flipper, we saw that the CV of the plate was almost 50%. After that, we followed the same protocol, but then we removed all the medium with the blue washer, and then filled it again with the buffer, and then the CV decreased to 14%. So for our assay, the medium in which the cells were seeded did clearly interfere with the readout. That is not always the case, so sometimes you do not need the blue washer, but for this assay, it had a clear effect. On this slide, you see the results of the flipper screen. So it was about 440,000 compounds, and I think it was about in 350 assay plates, 1536 plates. And what we always do is we calculate for each plate, we calculate the some statistical values like the signal over background, the Z prime. To assess the performance of the assay. So in the different colors, you see the different days. So the assay, the screen was performed in 5 days. The SB, so you see it a bit fluctuate, but overall the assay was okay. The Z prime value, in general, we have a cutoff of 0.5, so all the plates that has a Z prime of more than 0.5 are good, and below that we invalidate the assay because the variation in the plate is not good enough or is too high. We also include at several places in the assay QC plates. So the QC plate contains our reference, and we calculate the PIC50 of the reference to see if it's the same as we always have. On this slide, you see an example of how our data looks real time on the flipper. So on the right side, you see the full 1536 well plate, and we have just highlighted two of those wells that you see on the left. And this is just an example to give you how you see the flipper data on screen. Optimization phase, we also have a robustness set. And we used Rubin's set to get an insight in the possible false positives we might get during a screen. So the robustness set actually contains different groups of compounds. So we have different classes of compounds that can be divided in aggregators, chelators. We have a group of compounds we call clean compounds. So these compounds have no known chemical effects, like redox effects. We have compounds that are colored, luciferase inhibitors, compounds that are fluorescent, and compounds that are redox or reactive. And as you can see on this slide, each compound group is colored with a different color, and they are scattered throughout the plate. And well, one would not expect a lot of hits in the clean compound group. So when we test this robustness set during optimization phase, if we get a lot of hits from our clean compounds, that would be a hint that during our true screen, we would get a high level of hits. And another thing we use the robustness set for is, for example, if you get a high level of actives in our aggregator group, that could mean that you could adjust your buffer. So what we then test is adjust adding detergents like 3 and 20 in order to try to reduce the number of actives. The same thing is for the redox group. So if you see a high level of high active rate in the redox group, and we can adjust our buffer, by adding, for instance, L-cysteine, or replacing DDT, which is often used in buffers by replacing DDT by another reducing agent. So in the next slide is an example we used the robustness for this essay. So on the left side, you see the different percentages effect of the compounds in the different groups. And what you see that in the fluorescent, there are few compounds that have an extremely high effect due to the fact that these are very fluorescent. In the image at the right, we have removed those fluorescent compounds from the analysis, so you can better analyze the other compounds. And what you then see is, for instance, that the clean compound has a few compounds that are high, but well, unfortunately, these clean compounds were adjacent to the highly fluorescent compounds. But if you take into account the locations of these compounds, then we had concluded that the active rate that we are going to expect from this screen was not that high. So just the outcome of this screen, so we tested approximately 450,000 compounds. From that, approximately 360 compounds were active, with a threshold of 40% or more. And after that, we tested these compounds in a serial dilution compound experiment. And from these, we could confirm 120 compounds. And these compounds were then tested in follow-up assays to select all of the best compounds. So this concludes the 1536 screening example using an potassium assay kit from Molecular Devices. In the next few slides, I would like to show you an example of the development of a calcium kinetic assay in close collaboration with Encaria. So On this slide, you see the assay principle is actually the same as we saw before. So you have a calcium, it's actually the same calcium assay kit as we saw a brief some slides before. So you use a dye that is calcium sensitive, and with changing calcium levels intracellular, you can measure it with changing fluorescence levels. Short the workflow. It has been fully automated now. So we dispense the plates, the cells with a multi-drop combi. After that, the cells are being cultured for up to 10, 11 days. And during those incubation days, the cells have to be refreshed in the medium every 2 days, which can be fully automated with the blue washer. Of course, the blue washer can evacuate the medium, but has also a dispense head in it. On the day of the assay, the dye is loaded, incubated, and after that, the transient calcium signal is measured in the flipper. So, with the flipper, there are a lot of parameters that can be measured that describe the beating pattern of the cardiomyocytes. So, like the peak frequency, the average width of each peak, the peak amplitude, or the peak spacing. And besides these, a lot of other parameters can be measured. So, everything is being measured and stored, and then you can choose at the export of the data which parameters you would like to have exported so you can analyze them. So for the development and optimization of the assay, we tested 660 compounds. These compounds were from the Schrenel cardiotoxicity library from Enzo Life Sciences. And these were tested in quadruplicates on the plate and were scattered throughout the plate. Next to that, we tested four references in a dose response curve. So these were BK8644. So that is a calcium channel agonist. We tested isoprenalinum, which is an adrenal receptor agonist. E4031, which is a HERG blocker. And finally, nifedipine. Sorry, that is an L-type calcium channel blocker. On this slide, you see the four reference compounds and what they are expected to do as compared to DMSO. So on this slide, you see a screenshot from the flipper with from the calcium flux readout. And this is this was after 30 minutes compound application. So we also did a few other time points, but I think this was the nicest example to show you with a clear effect of several compounds, and also the four references that you see below acted as expected. So we did this, we repeated this several times to determine if the assay was reproducible. And for that we did Pearson correlations between replicated plates. So on this slide you see an example. So what we did is we determined the change in effect of the amplitude. The BPM, so that's the beating frequency, and the change in peak spacing. And we did Pearson correlation, so we compared two individual plates. And so overall, with the Pearson correlation about 0.6 or higher, it's considered good. So for the amplitude and the BPM, you're pretty pleased that we have a pretty high Pearson correlation. So there was a good correlation between these two plates. So for the peak spacing, it was a bit lower, about 0.5, but we still think that overall the correlation between duplicate plates was good. So you're confident that the kind of toxicity assays as we have performed it now is reproducible over days and between plates. We have analyzed the effect of the compounds more. So on the left, you see three pictures. But again, the change in amplitude, the change in the BPM, and the change in the peak spacing within with DMSO. And one of the four reference compounds in the figures. And the gray shaded box are considered a significant effect based on the CV of our DMSO control. So every compound that are in the gray shaded box or above the reference compounds are considered to have a significant effect, either on amplitude effect or BPM or peak spacing. So on the right, we have aggregated all the compounds that have either an effect, a decreasing effect or an increasing effect on the amplitude, BPM and peak spacing. So some of the compounds have multiple effects on one of those parameters. Well, of course, when we have an assay, no matter which assay, we always try to convert it to a 1536 well, so in order to save materials and to increase throughput of a screen. So on this slide, on the left, you see a 384 well plate. With an example of a cardiomyocyte calcium flux beating, and on the left you see a 1536 well. So this was our initial attempt to miniaturize it to a 1536 well. So it seems that the beating rate is a bit higher in the 1536 well plate, but well, we haven't optimized it yet, so it was just the first attempt to miniaturize, so we have to confirm this in other experiments. One other thing I haven't shown in this webinar presentation, but we have also tested some of the compounds and references, and they do show the same effects as 384. So we are confident that we can miniaturize this assay in time. So our conclusion for the cardiac safety assay is that using the pleurocytes, cardiomyocytes, that we are able to perform an high throughput calcium transient assay using the Flipper TETRA screening system. There are some points we can further optimize, as mentioned, the miniaturization to 1536. We want to look at the long-term effects, so not hours, but days. The overall conclusion from this presentation. So the Flipper technology we have already used for about, I think, nine different assays. So it can be applied to a wide range of cellular-based assays. There are actually two important settings for the flipper that must be checked. And the most important one is the dispense setting, because we have seen that for different assays and different cell lines, these are different. So you cannot use one general setting for the different assays. Of course, for our support, for our pivot screening center, it's important that the flipper is integratable to a third-party robotic system. So we use the high-res system, and that goes very smoothly. And mentioned, well, all our assays, we prefer using 1536 well assays, so to reduce cost and increase the throughput. And as last conclusion, the flipper, we have determined that it's very useful for cardiac safety studies. So to conclude this webinar, we would like to thank all the people at PPSC and Cardia that were involved in generating this data we showed. And of course, we would like to thank Moloch Devices and LabRoots for the opportunity to present our data and this presentation. So thank you again.
Thank you, Helma and Sheng, for your presentations. A quick reminder for our audience on how to submit questions. Simply type them into the drop-down box located on the far left of your presentation window labeled Ask a Question and click on the Send button. Helma Vandenhoek and Sheng Wai Lum will answer as many questions as time permits. The first question is, do you see any plate edge effect using 384 or smaller plates for the flipper assay? And if you do, how do you deal with them?
Hi, thank you for your question. So, it has been a while that we have tested 384 plates, but for 1536, well, indeed, we do sometimes see plate effects. And, well, we do have some solutions or ways to solve them. So, the first thing I mentioned already in a previous one of the slides, that we, during the optimization, we look at different suppliers. And, well, I want to stress again that it is very important to test different plate suppliers if you see plate effects, because we have seen huge differences between the different suppliers. So some of the suppliers, for instance, Greiner, Corning, Perkin Elmer, it would give you a lot of insight to have them tested in the optimization phase. And also the physical form of the assay plates. So you have low base or high base assay plates. These can give very huge differences on the flipper or any other assay. Other things for plate effects, but I think it's general for all assays, not specifically for the flipper, is for instance, incubation times. Some of the assays are really temperature sensitive, so I think about some luciferase assays, which are temperature sensitive. So sometimes a bit longer incubation at room temperature to equilibrate the full plate to room temperature can eliminate much of your plate effects. It is not always possible to eliminate the plate effects. So in this case, we have occasionally done that. We leave out the outer wells, so we use only the inner part of the plate to test compounds. And another thing is, if you cannot remove or eliminate your plate effects, some of the software databases are able to apply some kind of algorithm on your data that removes the plate effect. But then you have to have a plate effect that is very consistent for all your plates that you have tested in your screening. So I hope that that will help your answer your question.
Well, thank you very much for that one. The next one is, how do you choose the compound concentration for the initial screening campaign?
The initial concentration is, we have most of the time a fixed concentration. So we have a library which has for all, let's say, the 400,000 compounds we have, a fixed solution. And then we test the compounds, for instance, in a 1,000-fold dilution or 400-fold dilution. It also depends on our customers. So we are CROs. We also test for other companies, and they then decide at which concentration they would like to test.
Thank you. I'm sorry. Did you have more to add? The next one is, what is the throughput of your UHTS when using the flipper, and how many plates and compounds can be tested a day?
Okay. Well, that actually depends also on the kind of assay you have. And, well, by that mean is the protocol for that particular assay, how many assay steps does that protocol have? And for instance, how long are you incubation times, how many incubation times? And also, what kind of dispensers are being used in the system? So, are you using a single channel dispenser, or maybe an 8-channel dispenser, which makes filling plates, of course, much faster? But in general, if we do a 1536 well plate screen using an ion channel on the flipper, well, we can handle at ease about 90 plates. And that would be approximately the same as 150,000 compounds. But of course, sometimes, depending on assay, we can do less plates, but sometimes we can do more. So, for instance, for other type of assays that are not read by the flipper, we can sometimes do 150 plates, or with other assays, well over 200 plates. So, in that case, we can test more than 250,000 compounds a day.
Thank you. The next one is, I have a technical question. What is your final serum percentage in both assays?
Sorry, could you repeat the question?
Yes.
I didn't.
The person says they have a technical question, and the question is, what is your final serum percentage in both assays?
It's depending on if the serum interferes with your assay. So we always start just to see if you can just start using the serum in which the cells are seeded. So normally we seed our cells in the 10% serum overnight, and then we perform the assay. And if your assay is not that sensitive for serum in your readout, we use that just that 10%. If it is, then we try to seed the cells in a lower percentage of serum, for instance 5%, 1% serum. And if that also interferes, then we could think about using the blue washer, which was also mentioned earlier in the essay, to remove the complete serum content of your of the essay, and then replace it with a buffer or medium without serum.
Thank you. The next one is, do you see any trend in screening with regard to cell types?
It's a good question. I think I see there's still more interest in the use of human-induced pluripotent stem cells, or in short, iPSC cells. So the cardiomyocytes that were used and shown in this webinar were actually iPSC-derived cells. So with iPSC cells, you have virtually an unlimited source of different cell types, which can be used for toxicity or safety testing. And also, I think over the last few years, the three-day culture has begun to be readily adopted into drug discovery pipeline because they have an improved relevance compared to the culture. So one can think about organoids, for instance, and there are now good 3D imagers on the market. Also, Molecular Devices has one, the Image Express. And PwC is now evaluating if what we can do in the 3D culture and these new type of cells.
Thank you. The next one is, you mentioned you would investigate also long-term effects of compounds on cardiac activity in terms of a day or even more, but is the dye not toxic for the cells when you would incubate them for such a long time?
Yeah, and in general, dyes, if you incubate them with cells for a longer period of time, well, cells are not happy with that, and the dye can indeed be toxic. So with respect to the cardiomyocytes, what you then can do is apply the compounds first and then incubate for as long as you wish. And after that, you can add the dye, incubate the dye with for 1 or 2 hours, and then do an analysis of the arrhythmic beating of your cardiomyocytes. The only thing is that normally what we do with the short-term effects is we first apply the dye, then we measure a baseline of the cardiomyocytes before you add compounds, and after that we add compounds and then measure the beating of your cardiomyocytes. So if you add first the compounds and then the dye, then you would not have the baseline for those cells.
Thank you. Looks like we have time for just one more question. Why is the position of maximum and minimum signals in two double columns on the left side of the plate and not scattered around so that it's not biased to one side of the plate and is representative of the full plate?
Yeah, that's a good question. From a statistical point of view, it would be better if you have your controls, your negative positive controls, randomly scattered across the plate, indeed to not to be biased by plate effects or something like that. So there are a few reasons we do not do that. So the most important reason is, I think, a practical reason. Most of our dispensers, but also many of the dispensers you can buy on the market are columnized dispensers, so they add per column the volume you need in the plate. So for that reason, it would be for that this particular dispenser not really possible to have a random scattering pattern on the plate. And also, well, for us, we have some kind of flow chart in place, and that has there its positive and negative controls in particular fixed positions. So it would take a lot of time and difficulty to have them scattered around. Another thing is we are, we are also as screening for other companies and other clients, we are actually bound to what plate format other companies have. And it turns out that actually all of them have fixed rows or extra columns for their controls. Some of them have their columns at the sides of the plate, of the plates, but all of them have them as columns and not randomly scattered throughout the plate. So it is more also kind of a standardization of your workflow that is most important to have.
Thank you. I would like to once again thank Helma Vandenhoek and Chung-Wai Lum for their presentations. Do you have any final comments?
No, it was our pleasure to give this webinar to answer the interesting questions. I hope a lot of people have learned something from this, and if there are any questions, they can contact us by mail.
Yes, we're always open for further discussions or questions. Feel free to contact us.
Well, thank you both again. I'd like to thank the audience for joining us today and for their interesting questions. Questions we did not have time for today will be addressed by the speakers via the contact information you provided at the time of registration. We would like to thank our sponsor, Molecular Devices, for underwriting today's educational webcast. This webcast can be viewed on demand through April 2019. LabRoots will alert you via email when it's available for replay. We encourage you to share that email with your colleagues who may have missed today's live event. Until next time, goodbye.